I've done a lot of photography over the years, 3 decades. Most of my income, even today, comes from the licensing of photographs. I'm working on a project right now called Finding Darkness, like Finding Darkness in Rural America. This is a shot that was taken about 35 miles west of Salt Lake City in the Rush Valley area. That is in a Bortle 4 looking into a Bortle Class 3 behind it. Over there in this area is Salt Lake City Metro, and we have about an 8 to 9 Bortle class. I mean, it's white out. You can only see maybe a dozen stars from where we are in the suburbs of Salt Lake City. Maybe some of you guys from the Salt Lake Astronomy Club can see more. But I remember when Stansberry Observatory started. They were about a Bortle 3 there. Now they're about a Bortle 6, I would say. Bortle class. We're going to talk about nightscape photography. What are nightscapes? Well, I didn't start this phrase, nightscapes. I didn't coin it, but I'm probably one of the one who has helped proliferate it more than anyone else. So I get to define what a nightscape is, okay? My definition of nightscapes are starry night skies with a landscape feature, okay? And I've written a book on that. Some of you may have read it. The stars in nightscapes, my definition, are points of light, not star trails. Now, I still take star trails. That's fine. But that's not mainly what I do. I photograph the stars as you see them. And a lot of people who have seen my photographs have come up to me and said, "What's that cloud thing in the sky?" And when I tell them it's the Milky Way, they say, "Well, is it real or is it Photoshop?" You know how jaded we become. And I want to assure you that it is really there. This is what you can see with the naked eye when you get in an area that's about a Bortle 2 or 3 class or even a 1. You can actually see the Milky Way with your naked eyes, just like I could when I was growing up in rural Oregon. And with your camera exposure, you expose more to the right and pick up more information. And then by adding a little bit of contrast in Photoshop or Lightroom, you get what you see on the right. Now, I haven't added saturation to that, just contrast, and usually by an S-curve. Now, most people have never seen the Milky Way with their naked eye. Why is that? Well, it's mainly because of light pollution. 90% of America has never seen the Milky Way, according to a report that just came out. Can you believe that? And that's because most of us live in the inner city or the suburban areas, and we can only see a few stars. We have to get out into a Bortle Class 3 or lower to really see the stars in the Milky Way. Luckily, here in Utah and in the West, except for the major cities, most of us can travel 25, 50 miles and be in a beautiful area to observe and photograph the starry night sky. We are so fortunate. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about planning for for shooting the stars in the Milky Way. In order to really get good pictures of the starry night sky, you have to be dark. And the best time to do that is when the sun is 18 degrees or more below the horizon. If it's 18 degrees below the horizon, it'll be just as dark than if it's 40 degrees below the horizon. Did you know that? Yeah. It's called the astronomical desk. So between 0 and 6 degrees below the horizon is the civil twilight area. Go beyond that, you get into the nautical, and then you get into the astronomical twilight. And below 18 degrees, it's the astronomical dusk. And that's the darkest period of the night, unless the moon is shining. And so for layman's term, the best time to photograph the starry night sky is during that astronomical dusk. And that's basically about 2 hours after sunset until about 2 hours before sunrise. Now, in some areas of the United States, it can be 1.5 hours, or it can be longer, and it depends on the season. But the rule of thumb is about 2 hours. Well, how do you find this astronomical twilight? Well, you can use programs like photo pills and things like that, or you can just use the good old U.S. Naval Observatory publishes charts, and that's what I use a lot. If you photograph slightly outside of the astronomical dusk, like, say, into the twilight, like this picture on the left was photographed during the astronomical dusk at about 3:25 a.m., and about 20 minutes later, I took the next photograph. You can see that I'm in the Tetons. See how much detail in the foreground you can see? That's because it's about 3 times brighter than in the other picture. We're getting it, we are into the astronomical twilight, and the contrast between the stars starts to lessen. And so the stars aren't as rich and the sky isn't as rich and deep, and the stars aren't as brilliant as they would be in the other picture. But there are certain things that you can see. So don't always give up shooting when you reach the astronomical twilight. But most of the time, you want to be within that astronomical dusk. Now, there's another twilight period that is in the civil twilight called the blue hour. How many like shooting in the blue hour? By the way, is it dark enough in here? Okay. We experimented in it. We thought it was pretty. This projector costs $48,000. It's the best projector they have. So they put us in this room. That was nice of them, wasn't it? So they said it's like 10 times brighter than the other projectors. So, yeah, we could go a little darker than this. Dave, if you're around, maybe a tad bit darker, but I think most people, this is pretty good. Okay, the blue hour is a period in the civil twilight area that is where the sun is between 4 and 6 degrees below the horizon. Now, it's about 500 times brighter than the astronomical dusk, but it allows you to still keep that blue sky like we have on the right instead of going black and pick up a lot of detail. In other words, I don't have to use my artificial lighting as much in either of these. As you would, well, actually, you have to use more artificial light in the blue hour than you do in the astronomical dusk. You have to use about 500 times as much. So it is definitely not low-level lighting during the blue hour. But you can do some fun things. But you can't see most of the stars, only a few of the brighter stars. Okay, I'm going a lot slower because we started 25 minutes early. Isn't that fun? So the other thing you have to do is plan for the moon. Even a little bit of moon, even a crescent moon, will take out a lot of the contrast. I think there are chipmunks behind us, that wall. The picture on the, that was supposed to be the AARP group through the wall. I'm serious. Okay, the picture in the foreground is a crescent, I think a quarter moon rise, and you can see it's wiped out most of the stars, except for Jupiter, that funny star that's called a planet. But then the other picture was taken in April with during the astronomical dusk during the new moon. And so there's quite a bit of contrast in the night sky. Now, we all know that your best time to go out and shoot nightscapes is during the new moon. But did you know that there are at least 3 days before and after the new moon in which that are totally moonless nights? In other words, the moon does not interfere with the astronomical dusk at any time during that period. Now, there might be a little bit, maybe 15 minutes or something like that. And the exact opposite is true on the 7 days around the full moon. There isn't a single minute that the moon isn't present during the astronomical dusk. So, a real pain. But then there are about 15 other days in the month, and you can get slivers of time, maybe 1 hour one night, 2 hours another night, 3 hours the next night. That's really playing havoc with our audio, isn't it? What is that? Yeah, it's like racquetball. So, escaping light pollution, you have to get, as I've said, in many cases about 50 miles away from a major city before you can get some serious night photography. How many of you ever go out to Knoll out in the West Desert? And that's not too far away, but you can really get some good dark skies out there. Now here's an area 15 minutes from Salt Lake City up at Brighton at Silver Lake, and it's a Bortle 7, but you're looking at Bortle Class 7, but you're looking out over to a Bortle 3, a Bortle 2 and 1 area, 3, 2, and 1 area, and that's why you're able to get that pretty good shot of the Milky Way. How many have been with me over at Silver Lake in the Brighton area on one of our photo walks? Good. So this is only 55 miles from Salt Lake City as the crow flies in the Mirror Lake area. This is not Mirror Lake, but one of the smaller lakes. And that glow on the right-hand side is Salt Lake City. So, you know, light pollution can be pretty. Let's talk a little bit about orientation, how we find our way under the night sky. Well, first of all, let's ask, what is the Milky Way? Now, this is a naked eye view. By the way, this is a five-shot stitch panorama with a 14-millimeter. And this is the camera exposure. This is adding a little bit of contrast. The Milky Way is a galaxy, and we're in the middle of it. And that's our closest other spiral galaxy neighbor, Andromeda Galaxy. So, when we look at the Milky Way, we're looking through or at, on edge, one of the two spiral arms of the Milky Way. And that brightest area is the core or the central bulge. Well, how do you find the Milky Way? Well, if you look up and there's about 88 constellations up there, but if you look at Sagittarius and Scorpio, the core of the Milky Way is right in between those two. I'm going to talk a little bit about how the Milky Way changes during the seasons. Most of you know that during the winter months, most of December, all of January, and a good share of February, the Milky Way goes on vacation for us here in the Northern Hemisphere. I used to think it went down to the Southern Hemisphere, but they tell me that's not the case. They have the same problem. And during their summer months, which is our winter. But the Milky Way starts to make the bulge, or the central core of the Milky Way, starts to make its way above the horizon in the last hour or two of the astronomical dusk in the very late winter and early spring of the year. This was, how many went to the Wendover thing that we got fogged and clouded out on last year? This was some of the graphics for that. I'm going to do a quick little five-slide situation. All of these were taken on February the 28th using the app Sky Guide. Thank you. And Sky Guide is a really neat app. The guy who developed it went around for 2 years all over the world and took 37,000 photographs of the night sky and combined them into one huge, gigantic file. And then with the aid of the computer, he can tell you wherever you are what the sky is going to look like. So it's not a simulated view, it's an actual view. Those are real images that he's using. So anyway, here's the core of the Milky Way coming up starting at 3 a.m. in February. Watch it come up. This is what Steve Bunderson and I saw just 2 weeks ago down in Hanksville area. And we photographed this Hanksville Butte, we call it. Nobody could tell us what the name of that thing was. And this was at about 4:30 in the morning. And that's a picture that Steve took of me at that butte, so you can see how big it is. So the Milky Way changes seasonally. That more vertical view of the Milky Way is in September. That more diagonal view is in June. And it changes hourly. That very horizontal diagonal view, it was at 2 o'clock in the morning in, I believe, in Zions. And the one that's more vertical was at 4:30 in the morning. So if you want to do panorama stitches of the Milky Way, you better do them before July 1st. It gets very difficult to get good panoramas. It can be done, but you don't get the rainbow effect that you do in the spring months. Watch this monthly movement of the Milky Way core. I'm taking each one of these with Sky Guide at 3 a.m. in the morning. So February 26th at 3 a.m., the next one's March 26th, and then April, all the same hour. And by June, at 3 a.m., the Milky Way is vertical. So we're not going to be able to get very good panorama pictures. But if we go at the beginning of the astronomical dusk at 11 p.m., we're going to get a nice diagonal view of the Milky Way. Okay? I wanted to take a picture of the Grand Tetons at Ansel Adams tripod holes at the Snake River Overlook for that classic shot, and I wanted to get the Milky Way behind there. And so I looked with Sky Guide and calculated that's on the 11th day at 2 a.m. each month. As you can see, in September, it goes right over the Grand Teton, just the way I wanted to in that picture. So that's how you orientate and plan. Now, the Milky Way, there's other parts of the Milky Way or the night sky than just the core of the Milky Way. Our beautiful winter sky has some neat features like Orion and Cirrus that are gorgeous. But I think we're all Milky Way junkies, aren't we? Milky Way core junkies here. And I love Sky Guide, how I can use it to find out exactly where the Milky Way is going to be. This was a picture at Pass Lake, and it told me exactly where it was going to be. Now here's an orientation I did from my living room for a location in Arizona down at Monument Valley, and it was exactly as it had predicted where it was going to be. Okay, now we're going to do what you all came here to talk about or hear about, is shooting Milky Ways. Well, first of all, I think we all know that we're up against a pretty big feat, because unlike the pictures we take in the daytime with our Nikons and Canons and Sonys and Pentaxes, hey, have you seen that new Pentax that has the tracker built into it? You pick it. It picks a couple of stars, and you don't even have to get the North Star, I don't think, and it will track your images. Of course, you have to be on a tripod. You can't handhold it, but it does a pretty nice job. Does anybody know what model that is? K1, yep. That have that feature now. So, amazing. Yeah. This is Eric, our specialist over here, says there are several cameras that do that now, not just the K1 Pentax. But the challenge that we're up against in photographing the night sky is that it's about 1/40 millionth to 100 millionth as bright as the sun. I mean, even the moonlight is 135 times brighter than starlight. So we have a challenge. I call it the Nightscape exposure dance. Trying to get the shutter speed slow enough to keep the stars from moving, the aperture big enough so that we can control those other two things, and try not to make the ISO so huge that it destroys the quality of our image with all the noise that it creates. And that at the bottom is our kind of our standard base exposure, and that's why you need lenses that are fast, that have fast apertures, and cameras that do well at 6400 ISO. That's if you're going to do a one exposure nightscape, which I've been doing for many years, but there are better ways. So shutter speed's probably our most important thing that controls a lot of things. With a 24 millimeter lens, if you shoot at 30 seconds, that'll make it a great 11x14 print. But try blowing it up to a 30x40, and you're going to see that, you know, it's moved quite a bit. You need to go down to a 15th of a second, and even have that down to an 8 seconds. And I say 15th of a second, I meant 15 seconds. So have it 30 down to 15, and maybe even have that down to 8, as you can see, makes it more pinpoint. Now, if we blew that up even more, you'd see that those stars were even a little bit oblong. But for a 40x60 print, you'll do just fine. So even for 11x14, that 30-second will work just fine. I've had a lot of people just starting into photography say, "And I only have a kit lens and a kit camera. I mean, I don't have hardly anything. And, you know, my biggest aperture is 4.5. How in the heck am I going to do this?" And I said, "Well, shoot 45, 60 seconds. But the stars will be blurred." Yeah, they'll be a little bit blurred. But if you show that on a 4x6 print, nobody will know. They'll think you're cool. Well, one of the keystones of good night photography is making sure you're in focus. I thought that was pretty much in all photography, but in night photography, it gets a little bit paramount. Because you're shooting wide open in many cases, and you're shooting with wide-angle lenses, even 1 millimeter off will give you that picture in the center. See the circles of confusion on the stars that are close to each other, how they're overlapping each other? Yeah. So you got to learn how to do manual focus. Autofocus doesn't work, folks. Now, in my ebook, I have the recipe for, you know, shooting. Most of you are beyond that. But basically, to start with, 30 seconds with a wide-angle lens, f2.8. You should have your camera on a tripod, should have pre-focused, taped down the focus in the daytime, and use 6400 ISO. If your camera, if your 5100 looks like crapola at 6400, go 3200. Yes, you'll be underexposed by a stop, but it'll probably still look pretty good. Okay, there are a lot of cameras out there, basic gear that you can use. How many, by the show of hands, how many of you are Nikon people? By the show of hands, how many of you are Canon people? How many have a Sony? How many have a Pentax? How many have an iPhone? I was in on a road trip 2 years ago giving lectures at a TV station all across the country, and the guy that was interviewing me said, now, I can't do this with my iPhone? No, you can't do this with your iPhone. So, sorry. Now, there are a lot of cameras out there, a lot of DSLRs and mirrorless cameras out there that you can use for this. But sensor size is pretty important. Even some of the new APS-C sensors and four-thirds sensors do a pretty good job now. A full-frame sensor is actually better. Pixel size does count. So that camera on the right there, that GoPro, that old model GoPro, its sensor is about 1/20th the size of that full-frame sensor. Ain't going to cut it. Glass is pretty important, too. And spherical elements really make a difference. And they control a couple of problems. One is chromatic aberration, and another one for astronomers is called coma aberration. And that, and there's a lens company out there, the Samyang Lens Optical Company that makes the Rokinon, that have come out with a series of lens. That lens on the left is a 14 millimeter, the one in the middle is a 24, and the one on the right is a 35. And they have a whole bunch of lenses out now. And most of them are very well corrected for coma, even wide open. Now, here's an example of coma aberration. See Jupiter over there on the right that looks like an angel with wings? And then here's a corner shot. Those look like flying saucers. Those are supposed to be points of light. And I bought a Canon lens here, a $2,000 Canon lens that didn't lose most of its coma aberration until f/2.8. So why did I buy f/1.4? Because I thought it would work. So I have to stop that lens down to f/2.8 to do any astrophotography. Here's an example of that lens on the right, wide open, and the very same stars with the Samyang Rokinon 24 millimeter wide open. And the lens on the left costs $550, and the one on the right costs $2,000. Okay, exposed to the right is the thing to do when you're doing astro night photography. In other words, give it as much exposure as you can without wiping out the highlight detail. So that middle image is where the central bulge of the Milky Way is starting to touch the midpoint of your histogram. Now that image right there is underexposed by about a stop. And that's where you don't want to be. You can get by with it, but you'll, and the guy is shooting at 3200 ISO. Believe it or not, with a good camera, that image, once it's processed correctly, will actually have more noise than the one at the bottom that was shot at 6400. That seems kind of strange, doesn't it? It's all part of the exposed to the right. Well, then you're doing that little dance again where you're trying not to have too much, your lens shutter open too much, or you're going to get star trails. They're in astronomy, there's the 600 rule. I like to do the 400 rule. When I made this slide, I said 450, sorry. But here's a blow up from the Temple of the Sun down in Capitol Reef. You can see the image in the middle was shot at 13 seconds, and the middle image on the right was shot at 30 seconds. Here's an enlargement of that. Can you see how much movement has happened in that 30-second exposure? Okay, so I have a chart in my e-book called The 400 Rule, and that's the better one to go by if you want to make good prints. Then there's another thing called air pollution, not light pollution, but air pollution. That picture on the left is taken one of the darkest parks in the United States, Bryce. But that is a flyway because of Las Vegas and Los Angeles, there is an airplane going over there every 5 seconds. And that 30-second exposure right there, there are no less than 9 aircraft. And that little chart there will tell you which plane is which. And the top one is a 737B. No, I'm not. I'm kidding. I can't. But I can tell you what type of aircraft they are, or whether they're a satellite, or the very bottom one is a true meteor. I remember a guy coming to one of my workshops, and he says, "Man, I got meteors. I got 3 meteors in my picture." I didn't have the heart to tell him they were airplanes, because he was so excited. Okay, spoiler alert. So only great night photography can be taken by people who purchase really, really state-of-the-art, the most expensive cameras, and the very best lenses. Or not. Well, you're going to learn some techniques tonight that allow you, with your kit lens and your 5100, to take some pretty decent pictures with some techniques called pano stitching, tracking mounts, which will add another $300. Whoops, there was the expense. But stacking doesn't require any money, but there's some free software out of there. The most expensive is like $29. Okay, I think all of us know what equatorial mounts are, or trackers, as we like to, as us photog guys like to call them. But trackers, I mean, equatorial mounts have been around for a long time. For a good amateur medium-sized telescope, they weigh about 30, 40 pounds, and you get to carry around a 30, 40-pound lead-acid battery to power it. So not exactly convenient. But as of several years ago, there are several good trackers out there that are only about a little bit bigger than your fist, weigh about 2 or 3 pounds, and they will carry payloads of 5, 7, 8 pounds, and they only cost about $300, $350, $400 at the most. And the principle is that you sight the tracker for Polaris, the North Pole, and then mount your camera to it, and then turn on the tracking or clock mechanism that rotates around the universe, the North Star. It's important to turn that on. I didn't do that here a couple of weeks ago, and nothing happened. So, but the results are pretty amazing. You can see that little blow-up section right here. We're blowing up that area there. Let's go to this next slide, and you can see that in order for a 50 millimeter to stop the stars, you got to go down to about 6 seconds. I find 4 or 5 seconds is even better. But that means I'd have to go to ISO almost 26,000. Well, look at the noise on that. I mean, some of the noise, you would say that those are stars. And that's not. It's noise. And then the one in the middle is the tracked one. And I haven't done a very good job of tracking. That was only for 1 minute at ISO 3200. If I'd gone for 2 minutes, I could have gone to 1600. 4 minutes, I could have gone to 800, and so on and so forth. But and then, of course, there's the same 56 seconds without tracking on the right. I wish you all could see the resolution that I'm seeing. Well, it's not bad up there, but there's a pretty good shot from a tripod, 13 seconds. Enlarged that area, and that's pretty good detail for 8,000 ISO. But if you can go down with the tracker, even only 108 seconds at 2,000 ISO, the detail is just incredible. Okay, we're going to talk about foreground lighting enhancements, and you do not, as you've heard, that there's a ban on a lot of light painting in the national parks. You do not have to have light painting to take some good night pictures and get good detail in your foregrounds. But you do have to take a second, longer exposure, usually 4 times to 8 times of what your sky exposure was in order to collect enough starlight bouncing off of the landscape. Which means that you have to take 2 pictures, one for the sky and one a longer one for the foreground, and then combine them together in Photoshop layers in a blend. And that's what I did here in Arizona in the Grand Canyon at about 3 o'clock in the morning. Boy, it was hard getting out of my sleeping bag that morning. But starlight is a very flat light, and that's why I like to do the artificial lighting. Or if the moon will cooperate, you can take a picture like I've done up there in the top middle with the moonlight, and then 5 hours later, when the Milky Way rose above the canyon, took that second picture and then combined them in Photoshop. Make sure that you have big flat rocks under your tripod if you're on sand, and that you have a bag full of rocks. And I would suggest that you don't take your first exposure until that tripod has settled in for half hour. Okay? This is the lighting equipment that I used to use 5 years ago. Nowadays, I am using item number 1 and number 11. I don't think I've touched any of those other lights hardly at all in the past couple of years. I did use Big Bertha number 3 in a little bit on a shot in the on a canyon. But for the most part, I use number 1 and number 11. That number 1 is an omnidirectional light. That's a cheap Walmart ripoff. And number 11 is a flat-paneled filtered LED. And then for omnidirectional lights, omnidirectional means that it shines 180, 300 degrees, 60 degrees. I used to use that big General Electric Coleman. It looks like a Coleman lantern, the same size as a green Coleman lantern, but it's actually LED. It uses like 8 D batteries. It weighs a ton. But I use those other little miniature and micro camp lights. This is the latest one from Gold Zero that I just love. It's a micro lantern, and it puts out plenty of light, and it's infinitely dimmable down to about 7 lumens. So it's just incredible what you can do with that. I don't use these big Bertha lights much anymore to light some of the big features. You can do that, but you better not do it in Arches or Zions or the Tetons right now. Zions is getting a little iffy. They haven't put out a proclamation on it yet, but it's getting a little tough. That feature down in Arizona, just outside of Monument Valley, was lit from a mile away by an 18 million candle power. So I don't do much of this type of lighting anymore, and I don't use spotlights like that. That's a snoot on the right. But Steve, you and I did this one a couple of years ago. But flashlights, because they're focused, allow you to do some pretty cool things and put them in your backpack. So don't throw that stuff away, even though I'm pushing low-level lighting. And don't throw away your spotlights, because they can, with the snoot, you can stand right in the middle of the picture and light that. You only have to retouch out the ends where it hits the edge of the snoot and retouch out that fat guy in the middle. So most of my lighting right now is done with stationary low-level lighting. This is in Fairyland area in Bryce. How are we doing on time? Oh, goody. Okay. And so there's the Z90, the F&V Z96. And you can put 3 of those in a backpack, and 90% of the time you'll only need 1. This is a shot of Temple of the Moon that was lit with just 1 of those. This is the only picture to appear in the International Dark Sky Calendar that was light painted. That's the only picture that's ever been put into the calendar that was where light painting was used. As you know, that artificial lighting has been banned from the Tetons, and it's not a terrible thing because there's only a few features in that, man-made features in that park, that where you really need artificial lighting. And my friend Mantani did a super job on the Thomas Moulton barn there on the right. My friend Wayne Pinkston and I have put together a site, a public service site called lowlevellighting.org. I own the domain and he's the webmaster. How many of you here know of Wayne Pinkston's work? He's a very prolific photographer. He shoots some great stuff down in the New Mexico Badlands. Anyway, this public service website is up there and has a lot of information on it, a lot of equipment links, and there's some tutorials. And we won't go through a lot of that here tonight because you can go there. But you can see by these three pictures, this is a Chimney Rock in Capitol Reef National Park. The picture on the left is a 25-second exposure, I believe, for just the sky. And then I took an additional two-minute exposure for the middle one and combined it with that sky picture. As you can see, starlight is a very flat lighting. But by using the same exposure, same 25-second exposure, where you get the sky and the foreground all in one shot. So you get it in one shot. You don't have to do any fancy Photoshop layering stuff. You get the picture on the right. And you would think that's a heck of a lot of light that we're using, but it is not. The amount of light that we're using, because it is on constantly during the whole exposure, is only about 2/200 of a lux. And that's just, even in the accent lighting, is just above the light you would get from a quarter phase moon. That's not much light. So anyway, there's some illustrations in there that show you comparatives on how this is done and all the science behind it. Here's an example of even headlights. It's really funny that Tetons does not allow you to use artificial light, but you can use headlamps to safely get to and from where you're shooting. Well, here's 2 seconds out of a 25-second exposure where somebody turned on their headlamp for just 2 seconds in that 25-second exposure. So, yeah. Okay, we're going to talk about 5 ways to produce more even lighting in your pictures. I see a lot of people are a little scared about doing some of this low-level lighting because, you know, they haven't done any studio work like Steve Bunderson and I. I mean, us crazy guys spent 20 years in the studio. I mean, these lights were just kind of they were an appendage of us. So here are 5 ways to give you more even lighting. Increase the distance, scrim the foreground, place the light higher, feather the light, use a second light for a fill, or maybe even a third. So here's an example. This is where Steve and I were 2 weeks ago at this Hanksville Butte. Steve, I had to artificially put that light in there and lighten the foreground in the top one because I knew where the light was supposed to be. I put it where it is in the bottom picture. We didn't actually shoot that top one, but that's a simulation of what it would look like. See how the butte on the left is more burnt out than the butte on the right, and how the foreground is more burnt out? By placing the light twice the distance away, not only do you get it out of your darn picture, but it evens the light because the fall off is not as great. Does that make sense? Yeah, you guys are good. Another thing is that if your foreground is getting too bright and burning up, you can place a berm or a big rock in front of that. Cue the big rock. Yeah, you have to go search for those things. They don't move too well. But I've scrimmed, that's called scrimming in the studio. I've scrimmed a lot of foregrounds with berms and big rocks, even trees, even juniper bushes. Elevate your light stand. This light stand that I had out here, which is right behind me, is made by Paul C. Buff. Well, he orders them. He probably gets them from China and puts his label on. But that little $39 light stand will go 10 feet high. And so that has really helped me to photograph a lot of items and not burn up the foreground. Well, the fourth thing is to feather your light. Don't aim the center of your light at your subject. Aim it just to the left or right of your subject, or in this case, aim it above your subject. You're using the edge of the light, not the center of the light. What's that? Yes, penumbra. Very good. And then if all else fails, use a second light. Here at the little tree in Zion's, we're using a second light, which is 1/4 the power of the main light. And in this little grove of aspen trees, we're using two lights, and we're using two principles. We're using not only a second light, at 1/3 the intensity, but we're backing both lights back instead of from this position to this position or from this position to this position, thus decreasing the fall off and evening the light. Now, some people have asked me, well, how do I know where to really place my lights? I'm not a good studio photographer. Well, I want you to think logically. In this picture over here, that's not actually lighting that, but that is the light source, isn't it? That is the light source. So make sure you put your lights over here on the same side as the central bulge so it looks natural. In this image, same situation, but we've also got this light pollution coming from the city, which kind of simulates what's going on here. And that picture on the left is by my good friend Wayne Pinkston. I don't want to take credit for that. Hey, we're going to talk about one of the main reasons we came here tonight, and that's ways to reduce nightscape noise. And that you can do quite inexpensively. One is by multiple image pano stitching. Second is by exposure stacking. Third is by tracking, four is by combining one and two, five is by combining one and three, and then there's a sixth option, astro modification to your camera sensor, which Clarence Spencer is going to talk about. Okay, here's a shot that I did in October down in the Virgin Gorge area. This is part of my book. So I'm aiming 90 miles down the Virgin Gorge, at exit number 18, Virgin Gorge is one of the most expensive roads to build that ever was going through that canyon. But it's really a dark area except where the freeway is. And but over towards the southwest is that darn city, Las Vegas, the city of lights, city of sin, or whatever you want to call it. But look how bright that sucker is. But anyway, I shot this in two ways. One is the single exposure, 20 seconds, ISO 5000, excuse me. And then the other one was by stacking. If you do only about 3 to 5 exposure stackings, you probably want to keep your exposure about right, or you can underexpose by as much as 1/3 of a stop. If you go 6 to 9 exposure stops, you can underexpose by as much as 2/3 of a stop or exposure value. You go 10 exposure stack or more, you may underexpose by as much as 1 full stop or 1 exposure value. But here's the result of a single exposure. I'm blowing this up at 100%. And then there's the stack of 8. See how much less noise there is? What you're doing is you're stacking the stars on top of each other, and the computer program is putting a median filter on everything in between. A median, not a medium, a median filter. That's a filter, and filter that averages things. And it will blend the noise factor in the sky area. Here is it blowing up at 200%. And not only does stacking allow you to reduce the noise, but look how I've been able to go to down to only 8 seconds instead of the normal 13 or 15, which really reduces the star movement. Can you see on the right one? I mean, there are stars that are appearing that you can't tell the difference between them and the noise on the left side. So pretty amazing. One of the best apps out there for stacking is unfortunately on the Macintosh side. How many of you are Mac users? Well, that's Utah is a pretty interesting town. We have probably twice the number of Mac users in this town than we do in other parts of the country, except Silicon Valley in California. But this program, up until a few months ago, was $19.95. It's now $29.95. Not a heck of a lot to pay, though, is it? But as you can see in this program, what it does, you put in like my 7, 8 images that I shot. And what you're doing in stacking is that you're trying to shoot just as fast as you can. You wait only 1 second for it to start writing to the card, and you fire off the next one. And you try to keep your exposures as short as possible. And remember, if you stack enough images, you can underexpose by as much as a whole stop. Well, it finds the stars for you, and then you can help the program out by telling where the sky ends and the land begins. And by just running your brush across there close to the land. And then you tell it that you want it to map the sky, or in other words, make a mass for the sky. As you can see, there's a couple of areas that it didn't get. You take the sky brush and paint those, and if there are any problems here in the land, you take the land brush and paint those. And then you tell it to align the stars in the sky, and then it creates a mask that it outputs that you can use as an alpha channel in Photoshop if you want, but you don't need it because it does it for you. But it gives that helpful thing. Now, the other thing, item number one I mentioned was to do multiple stitch images in a panorama. A lot of you guys are doing super wide panoramas like Eric here. Eric does very wide panoramas. I mean, that's what a panorama is, right? But did you know that you can do multiple stitch normal panoramas in the same aspect 2-to-3 ratio, just like your camera shoots? By taking, here's a 24 millimeter shot, the area that it covers. Why not take a 50 millimeter, put it in the vertical position, and do 4 overlapping by 50% shots like that? And now you have an image that has twice as many pixels. And it didn't cost you any money. So here's a shot I did 2 weeks ago with Steve when he wasn't looking. Is I did 7 overlapping, and I forgot to bubble level my tripod. That's why it is not even at the bottom. But thanks to Content Aware, we saved our bacon. Okay, let me move that cursor out of the way. Okay, so anyway, there's an unprocessed image, pano stitch, 7 stitches, and boy, you ought to see this baby big. So anyway, there we've cropped it. We've cropped out the light where the light was, and we've got the same aspect ratio, 2-to-3. And there's a 24 millimeter on the left that I shot. It has quite a bit of distortions. And the image on the right hasn't been processed completely yet the way I want it. But look at this. Look at the difference between those at the same size magnification. Is that incredible or what? Now, Eric over here does this on a tracker, and you know, his panorama, this was, he does multiple image stitches, sometimes what, into 20, 24? And he's tracking them. So each exposure is like 2 or 3 minutes. So this guy is serious. Okay, here's a tracked image that I did at Factory Butte. I'm not going to show you the foreground. There are the two exposures. The left one is tracked for the sky. The tracking is turned off so we can get a sharp view of the land. Remember, the land appears to move when you're tracking. Okay, but the difference that tracking makes is just incredible. And that's with just one. Okay, we don't have time to talk a lot about post-processing and ethics, but panorama stitches and even HDR is acceptable by National Geographic. Did you know that? But I just want you to know that I use the curves in both Photoshop and Lightroom to process my image. And the reason why is so that I do not blow out the highlights like you see there on the right side. Okay, this is a virtual guest person. This is Rolf Rohner out of Switzerland. He's an airline pilot. Do you feel like you're in good company there, Roger? Yeah, he's a good guy. You can read more on his bio when we publish this thing on YouTube. But he does a lot of stacking, and he uses an Astro modified camera. Now there's an APS-C 7D on the left, vertical shot. That's at Elephant Rock. And on the right is his Astro modified Canon 6D. He says the temperature there was 105 degrees that night. There's a shot of the Matterhorn that he's done, 14 stacked images, an image stack of 14 exposures, 10 seconds each. This is right here next to us at Pass Lake in the on the edge of the Uintas. This is just one, I think it was five image stack. Incredible detail. Yeah, five and four for the foreground. Here's at the John Moulton Barn. And we'll blow that up. Look at the difference that stacking makes. And it doesn't cost you any money. Manish Mamtani, he comes from India. That's a drone selfie that he did with him and his wife. He's one of the most published amateur photographers out there. He has 1 million likes on his Facebook account. This is a shot that he did using my light painting at Mesa Arch. And that's a single exposure image with a 14 millimeter. Excuse me. Yeah. Now, this was the panorama, excuse me. This is the panorama version that he did. He does have, I didn't put in the single image, but this is the panorama. It's seven vertical stitches with a 14 millimeter, and there are his images at the bottom, the raw images, and the top 10 images are for this shot of the Garden of Eden in Arches that he did. And this is another one that he did with my light painting at the Fins in Devil's Garden. And now we're going to turn the time over to Eric.
So like Roy said, I use tracking mounts for most of my nightscape photography these days. And as he had mentioned previously, this is technology that has its roots mostly in telescope imaging and observing, but a number of companies have brought to market, Yeah, Does that work? Okay. But a number of companies have brought these tracking mounts to market, and they're reasonably affordable, you know, in the range of a couple hundred dollars, and they're much more lightweight and portable. He had mentioned, you know, telescope mounts. I have a smaller telescope mount, but even that and all the gear weighs upwards of 60 pounds, and so that's not really something reasonable to drag out to take wide-field images. So these smaller mounts are great. You can attach your DSLR and a wide-angle lens. This one has a counterweight setup, but a lot of them don't even have that, and you don't really need them. At wide-angle focal lengths, you can take multiple minute exposures without developing star trails, as he's shown. Let's see. So Royce asked me to put together a small list of pros and cons, detailing what I think are the most important features and drawbacks of using a mount like this. So probably the biggest thing that an astrophotographer has to overcome is, as he mentioned, capturing a very small amount of light in a limited exposure time, usually 10 to 30 seconds. And so that generally drives photographers to do things like increase their ISO to high levels. He mentioned 6,400, I've seen as high as 20,000. But when you do increase your ISO levels, generally what happens is you decrease the dynamic range of your sensor and increase a lot of noise. He mentioned that starlight is very flat, and so if you do decrease your dynamic range, you're, you know, essentially capturing even flatter light than normal. And the problems with noise at high ISO are well documented. So the biggest advantage of using a tracking mount like this is just being able to lower your ISO, thus increasing your dynamic range and decreasing noise, and also being able to stop down your lens. Royce mentioned he spent $2,000 on a Canon lens, and it's plagued with poor coma and chromatic aberration. You know, an alternative would just be buying one of those Samyang lenses for $300 or $500 and then spending $300 on a mount like this and not really having to worry about coma or chromatic aberration at all. So the next main advantage, which is related to the first, is that when properly aligned, you can take long exposures of the sky, you know, upwards of 10, 15 minutes at a wide angle. And not have to worry about developing star trails. And that's a huge advantage in terms of, you know, lowering ISO and stopping down your lens. And of course, there are now several reasonably priced and highly portable mounts on the market. He showed the Ioptron Sky Tracker. There's the Vixen Polari. This is the Star Adventure. There's an AstroTrack. I mean, there's probably about a half dozen reasonably priced mounts, around $250 to $500. And they all weigh, you know, less than 10 pounds, so it's not a huge burden to throw that in your pack and go out and take your DSLR and wide-angle lens and be able to capture great images. That's not to say there aren't cons. I guess I should move forward. So probably the biggest drawbacks with using something like this is that you're going to essentially double, at a minimum, the time it takes to collect all your exposures to put together even a single image. He had shown pictures from Hanksville, or I think it was Hanksville, where the foreground was very blurred. And so it's, you know, when you take a picture from a tripod, the longer your exposure is, the more star trailing you're going to have. Well, when you take a picture on a tracking mount, the longer your exposure of the sky is, the more blurring of the foreground you're going to have. And so, you know, I generally take exposures in the 1 to 5 minutes range and double that. You know, have to take a 1 to 5 minute exposure of the foreground to get the same levels and the same exposure. And so essentially you're sitting at 2 to 10 minutes just for a single image, whereas with, you know, a fixed tripod, you're generally in the 10 to 30 second range for even a single image. And the second drawback being, of course, now you have to be able to merge those two images to create a final natural product where, you know, you can't tell the difference between the tracked image and the untracked foreground. And finally, to be able to use one of these mounts, you have to be able to align it to the Earth's rotational axis. In the Northern Hemisphere, that means you have to actually be able to see Polaris. In the southern hemisphere, you have to be able to see a constellation like Octans. And depending on where you're shooting from, that might not be possible. You know, a lot of places, your view of the northern or southern skies are blocked by trees or arches or other natural features. So just some things to keep in mind. Here are a couple examples of some shots I've taken. This one was taken up at Moosehorn Lake, not far from Mirror Lake in the Uinta Mountains. And I think we're going to zoom. Oh, guess not. So these are all the raw exposures for that one single image. This one was 21. Is that right? I think it said 21 total images. And so, you know, the sky and land shots are each 2.5 minutes. The reflection shots are 1 minute. And an image like this can take upwards of an hour to put together. In terms of quality, this is the same thing Royce was showing. This is the tracked image of the sky. You can see foreground is pretty blurry. And this is one of the foreground shots, and you can see star trailing is much brighter. So this is the final image I put together. And one thing to really notice is the increased detail in things like the dust lanes. Rho-Ophiuchi complex is much more visible and vibrant. This is Mars here, and this is Saturn up here. The Lagoon Nebula, you know, these are all things that generally with a fixed tripod set up at 10 to 30 seconds exposure, you might not be able to get that kind of level of detail. A little bit more zoomed in. Again, Rho-Ophiuchi complex. Those are things that tend to get washed out in shorter exposures. This is a shot just outside Stanley, Idaho, looking towards the Sawtooth Mountains. God, the air glow was just amazing that night. It looks like a river, actually. Again, this is Mars and Saturn. There was a lot of dew on the meadow, and so it formed on my lens, and you end up getting these diffraction spikes, which is, yeah, great until you can't see through the lens anymore, and then you're like, guess I'm done taking pictures. These are all the raw exposures. This one was only 9 total shots. And we're going to zoom in here a little bit. Same thing. Rho-Ophiuchi stands out very well. You can even see some of the red. Up here is the Zeta-Ophiuchi. And yeah. No, it wasn't at the time. I've since done my cameras myself, but... yeah, you don't need, I mean, if you can take long, low ISO, and so your dynamic range of your sensor is much higher, you can pick up, you know, fainter signals and not have to worry about, you know, raising exposure in post-processing or something like that. All right. Yeah, if people want to come over and check this out later, feel free to do that, and I'll answer any questions anybody has.
Well, let me make sure I'm close enough to the mic. Does that sound okay? Okay. I don't want to leave my face up there very long, so we'll move on quickly. But basically, I'm an electronics geek. I'm a techie guy and a photographer on the side. I started about 17 years ago a company called Spencer's Camera. We primarily focused on camera repair work at the time. And then with the advent of digital cameras, especially better quality SLRs over the last 10 years, we've specialized also in modifying those cameras. So, and that word modify to some people might be a little scary. We're not gutting the camera and throwing a bunch of junk parts in it, anything like that. What we do is we specifically modify certain parts, most importantly the imaging sensor of the camera, so that it's more sensitive to light, which then gives you many great benefits if used properly. And also, let me before I get into it and forget to mention this, every modification we perform will still enable you to use the camera for normal, everyday, daytime photography just by applying a filter to your lens. So if anybody has that question, hopefully that answers that already. How many of you in here think that night sky photography is tough? Okay. I think it's really tough to get it just right, like Royce's work. Oh, and before we get too much farther, can we all give Royce a round of applause? This is wonderful. Thank you, Royce. So, night sky photography, especially if you get into telescope work, it is extremely difficult. Nightscape photography is not anywhere near like telescope photography, which we do a lot of modifications for people that do that. But the benefit is pretty obvious right here. Here's a Canon 70D, which is a decent crop sensor camera, APS-C size sensor. That's a 30-second exposure with the same ISO, same lens, about 30 seconds apart. You can see the dramatic or pretty significant amount of light capturing capability that a modified camera will provide. Now, that's not a great picture. It's just one to give you a good analogy of what the light capturing capabilities are. Yeah, that's only at 1600 ISO. Most of the images you've been seeing earlier are either close to or near 6500 or 6400 ISO. What's the benefit of shooting at a lower ISO? Significantly less noise. Okay. There are lots of great techniques that should be implemented, including the image stacking, tracking, all of those things. I'm a firm believer, as many people are, that the closest you can get by getting a perfect image straight out of the camera, then the better off you are. It's easier to compose, you know, and create a great final image if your initial image right out of the camera is fantastic. That's the goal. Well, by having a modified camera, it's one step closer to that, a pretty significant step. You know, you pull out all the tricks in the book to try to do the or get achieve the greatest image you can, and this is a great way to do it. So this is a little closer shot of the same image. These are what's called, there's different types of modifications for astro type imaging, nightscape type imaging. There are really two great options. And I have, you know, different opinions on which ones are better and for different reasons. A full spectrum camera modification means basically we remove the blocking filter that's inside the camera, and then to keep the focus correct, edge to edge, and other issues that come up, we also replace it with something else. Now you can just remove the filter and adjust the focus, and the results will be okay, but in order to keep edge-to-edge sharpness, we replace that filter with a clear piece of quartz. It's finely polished quartz, it's very, very clean. What that does, it allows the camera to see ultraviolet light, visible light, and to the near-infrared spectrum. That can create some hurdles or minor difficulties. One, when you have a full-spectrum camera, the colors can start to get a little wonky or weird, especially when you're using artificial lighting. Now, myself, personally, using these images as examples, I use one of those LED panels that Royce mentioned earlier, the small little panel with the warming filter. It's around $100. It keeps the colors for your foreground objects very natural. If you use unfiltered LEDs and you start getting weird blues and even some magenta or purple colors, that's when you're using a full spectrum camera. Now the other option is what's listed over there on the right, which is a visible plus hydrogen alpha filter. There's a lot of misconceptions about what that is. Some people think you're just putting a hydrogen alpha only filter in the camera, which is pointless. It's, you know, creates tons of other problems. What this filter does is it allows the camera to see only visible light and then a little bit more into the part of the spectrum that's called hydrogen alpha. That's where most of your red nebulosity comes from different nebulae in the Milky Way, all the nice red colors you get around Orion, that really comes out great with that filter. The downside to the visible and plus H alpha filter is it's less sensitive than the full spectrum camera. Full spectrum cameras are roughly half, or will require half the exposure as an unmodified camera. It's almost twice as sensitive. A visible plus H alpha camera is only about 10% more sensitive. So it's more sensitive, but it's very sensitive in the right areas. So when you do a normal 30-second exposure, you know, 6400 ISO, let's say, all that red nebulosity that you have a hard time getting, and even the sky glow will come out much cleaner and brighter. It's much more visible. We also implement a heat reduction system in our cameras that we can provide. That's basically a complicated or complex heat sink that we attach to the back of the imaging sensor. Noise on your imaging sensor is one of the deadly issues of heat on your imaging sensor is going to create lots of noise. You do longer exposures, you're going to generate a lot of heat in the camera, which will then generate digital noise. Most of these cameras, which we've worked on every model out there many, many times, most of them don't have anything for any kind of a heat sink or heat dissipation system. In fact, the newer cameras, they have a circuit board attached right on the back of the imaging sensor, which it's creating heat while the imaging sensor is creating heat. So that's an add-on that we can put into your camera. It helps the noise reduced, keeps the noise reduced, which again is that end result that you want, to have the cleanest, sharpest, least noisy image straight out of the camera. Both of these images, by the way, are single exposures. No compositions whatsoever. And really very little minor, you know, cleanup, a little bit of adjustment in Photoshop. So that's the service we provide. Again, it may not be for everyone, but it is a very good additional tip or trick to use to get great nighttime images. And again, thank you, Royce, for allowing us to do it. Yes?
Can I ask you a question?
Of course.
Are we in the Q&As now?
Sure.
Your service on average is about $350 for the modification, plus about $150 for the heat sink. Is that correct?
Yes. For most cameras, it's $325 or $350. The heat sink is $125 or $150, depending on the camera.
Good. A lot of my friends are taking their older cameras that they were going to put on eBay and taking them to places like you and doing the Astro modifications. Is that a good idea, or should I be getting newer technology on these Astro modifications, or is something like an older 6D on Canon?
Very good question. Very good question.
D600 on a Nikon.
Sure, okay. Sure. So, sensor technology, every time a new camera comes out, the sensors are better. Sometimes they make giant leaps in technology for a much cleaner sensor, you know, for especially night sky imaging. It's just tough to capture almost zero light. The newer the camera, the better it is. There are some out there that are still terrible cameras. I'm not going to stand up here and tell you I'm a Nikon guy or I'm a Canon guy, whatever. If you go to my website, you'll see. these shots right here were both shot with Canon 6Ds. Okay, it's not the newest, latest, greatest technology, but it's phenomenal. The camera is very clean. The Nikon D600 and D610s are phenomenal cameras for you Nikon shooters. Now, Canon, the 5D Mark IV, it's amazing. Just an extremely amazing camera. I currently shoot a Canon 5DS. There's lots of people out there that say that's a noisy camera. I'm here to tell you it's not. It is a 50 megapixel camera that when you go down to the pixel level, it is just as noisy or equivalently noisy as anything else. Sony A7 series, phenomenal cameras. But the A7R Mark II is terrible. The reason isn't because it's a bad sensor. And the same with like the Nikon D810. It's a terrible camera for astro modification. That's not to say it's a horrible camera for general use. The reason is there are technical design flaws that will not allow a modification without creating an internal infrared light leak. Now, when you do a 30-second exposure at 12,000 ISO, your image is destroyed by that sensor. So you can go to my website. There's a recommended camera list. Stay away from those cameras. But there are dozens and dozens that are phenomenal, phenomenal great cameras. I'm, you know, without getting in too much trouble, I'm a Canon guy, have been from the day I was born. As a techie, I'm a Canon guy 100 times more so. There's lots of design mechanical issues with everything else that I just cannot stand. But that's me. It's like, go to your car mechanic, what's the best car out there? He's gonna hate certain cars when other people are gonna love certain cars. But really quickly, if you choose a great Canon camera, you're not invested in a bunch of lenses, you will not go wrong. I will tell you that, yes.
You said that what you need to be able to use this in daylight is another filter. Can you talk a little bit about that? I mean, I've got, you know, 14 millimeter f/2.8. It's tough to put filters.
Sure, that's correct. In fact, we just started stocking 150 millimeter UV. So the question was, when you have a camera modified, what kind of filtering do you have to use the camera for normal daytime scene, landscape, family pictures, whatever? I use my current camera. I have three cameras. They're all Astro full spectrum modified cameras. I shoot portraits for family members. I do, you know, kids soccer games, everything with the same camera. I just use what's called a UV-IR hot mirror filter. What that filter is it's the equivalent of the filter that we remove from your camera. So it's going to block ultraviolet light and infrared light, leaving only the visible spectrum for the camera to see. Your auto white balance functions will work fine. Everything works perfectly fine when you attach that filter to the front. The difficulty, as the question was, what about these ultra wide lenses that have those huge bulbous elements on the front? Well, there are filters for that. We now stock the 150 millimeter filters. They're like this big. You can put on your Nikon 14-24, the Canon 11-24, or the Rokinon 14 millimeter, and they work flawless. You can still stack neutral density filters to those. Oh, also one added benefit to a full spectrum camera, since it is now infrared sensitive, you can use it as an infrared camera as well by attaching an IR filter to your lens. Set a custom white balance, and you get beautiful landscapes in infrared, all with one camera. Any other questions before I sit down? Yes, go ahead. Yes, so the question is, can you stack additional filters with the UV-IR filter? Yes, you can. I didn't bring my laptop or anything, but I have many shots I've done with 10-stop ND filters, with a hot mirror filter or with an IR filter, any stack of filters will work just like on a normal camera. Now, we also, if you were to select the full spectrum option, we also sell the visible plus H alpha filter as an external filter. So for versatility's sake, the full spectrum camera option is by far the best option. But then there's the added expense of those filters. Now, I always get the next question is, how much are the UV-IR filters? For an 82 millimeter filter, it's about $140. Smaller gets smaller in price. The big ones, the square ones, to be honest with you, I haven't set the price yet. We just got them in. But I think they're gonna be about $200, just at the mere expense of getting them in. And we only have a limited supply. We will have within the next 30 days all of the IR filters, everything possible in the 150 millimeter size for the bigger wide angle lenses. So, great question. So the time frame, once you get the camera to us, our turnaround right now is 4 to 5 business days. In the winter months, which is our slow time, it's almost next day. But as spring gets a little busier and summer comes, it's about a week time on average to get one turned around and then either shipped back to you or you can come pick it up. So, warranty, we cover the conversion process for a year. We do sell cameras pre-modified. So if you bought the camera from us, and that's a great question, because if we modify your camera, your stock warranty is then void. Once we crack into it and start playing with things, that sounds terrible, I know, but once we start tweaking things, the camera manufacturer's gonna go, oh, we don't like that, we're not gonna cover it. But we cover it for a year if you buy the camera from us, no matter what happens. Well, unless you take it swimming, we're not gonna cover that. That brings up another question, or another usual question is, when we modify the camera, we aren't only modifying the sensor itself with an astro modification. With a regular infrared modification, which is less expensive, that's really all we do. But with an astro modification, it also creates, well, the inherent nature of astrophotography creates some limitations that have to be helped or overcome in the camera. It's tough on a camera. So we implement additional light baffling material that will help capture and stop stray reflections that are created by some lenses. We also add extra anti-static strapping on the sensor and other parts of the camera to reduce static buildup, which can create noise. And also some movement dampening material in some cameras that are really, they create a lot of movement and vibration when the mirror moves. So we add all of that to the astro modification as well. Also, before I forget, with Canons and soon to come the Sonys and Nikons, the dust reduction system will be retained as well. To do that, we may charge a little extra because it takes about 2 hours each one to remove the dust reduction system off of the sensor and then reattach it to the new filter. So when you get your sensor dirty, you clean it and it shakes it off for you. Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks again, Royce.